This is the day of the victory of our Lord and ours as well, if we can access it. Peter's having one heck of a time access it. So Jesus has to say, Peter, do you love me? Not once, not twice, but three times. Do you love me? We come here today because we say, yes, we do, Lord, love you. Then he says the most important words of all. Then follow me. To prepare ourselves to follow the Lord, let us open our hearts to receive his grace.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, Jesus revealed himself to his disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. He revealed himself in this way. Together were Simon, Peter, Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, Zebedee's son, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will also come with you." So they went out and got caught into the boat and got in it. But that night they got caught nothing. When it was already dawn, Jesus was standing on the shore, but his disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, have you caught anything to eat?" They answered him, "No." So he said to them, "Cast the net over the right side of the boat, and you'll find something." So they cast it, and were not able to pull it in because of the number of fish. So the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he tucked in his garment, for he was lightly clad, and jumped into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, for they were not far from shore, only about 100 yards, dragging the net with the fish. When they climbed out on shore, they saw a charcoal fire with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you just caught." So Simon Peter went over and dragged the net ashore full of 153 large fish. Even though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come, have breakfast." And none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" Because they realized it was the Lord. Jesus came over and took the bread and gave it to them, and in a likely manner, the fish. This was now the third time Jesus was revealed to his disciples after being raised from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
This was the third time that Jesus appears to his disciples, resurrected from the dead, and yet it takes so long for them to access the resurrection. Here we are in the third Sunday after Easter, and my question to myself and to the congregation is, have we accessed that resurrection? Do we feel it? Are we aware of it? Do we know that we are going to live forever? And the question is, I don't know, because it depends on where you access the resurrection. Most of us are very much like Peter. It takes Peter a long, long, long time to get it. Peter still doesn't get it today because he's accessing God through his head. He had a flash of genius when he recognized Jesus as the Messiah, but after that he went right back to the old Peter, who is all caught in his little prefrontal lobe that is always dissecting and comparing and saying this is good and that's not so good, and he's trying to get it through his thick skull. And I think when we try to access the resurrection through our thick skull, we do no better. And it's kind of odd because resurrection's all over us. I mean, it's all nature shows us what resurrection looks like. The bulbs that are reblooming, the seeds that are planted and all burst into beautiful color and flower. So nature is saying, here's, you want to see what it looks like? The caterpillar that turns into a butterfly. Those are wonderful things, but we keep on saying, yeah, but well, we're like Thomas. Thomas is trying to come through his head as well. He said, unless I put my fist in the side and finger in the holes, I'm not going to believe. Or as Lewis Black once said, oh, the angels take you up to heaven. He says, I've never seen a photograph of that. Well, neither have we. And so we have a real hard time accessing this great reality, but there's another way to come to it, and it is the way of the heart. The physiologists are now discovering that the heart has knowledge. It's heart knowledge. It's a different way of accessing reality. It's intuitive. It's real. It's called the way of the heart. And if we want to really come into communion with what's going on here, that's the only way we can go. There is one who represents that in the scriptures. He's kind of an esoteric figure. He calls himself, or he is called, the Beloved Disciple. Now, the Beloved Disciple appears at the very end of the Gospel of John. And we hear nothing of him in the synoptics in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And the question was, well, who is this mysterious Beloved Disciple? The one that Jesus loved. The tradition, according to St. Augustine, although many modern scholars today kind of wonder if it's really true, but Augustine says, no, that's John himself. You know, when St. John the Evangelist, he was by far the youngest of the disciples. He lived to be the oldest of the disciples. He couldn't have been over 17, maybe 18 years old when he walked with Jesus. And Augustine says, that's him. And he so loved the Lord. We find the Beloved Disciple for the very first time. He appears about five or six times in the end of John's Gospel. The first time we see him, he is in communion with Jesus heart to heart. As a matter of fact, Jesus is telling the disciples, someone's going to betray me. And everybody goes, who is it? Who is it? Who is it? Who is it? And Peter says to the Beloved Disciple, Peter, who's trying to get it through his thick skull, what's going on? Who is it? Well, now John's got his head against the chest of Jesus, so we've got heart-to-heart communication. Jesus can't refuse him anything. Who is it, Lord? Oh, it is the one with whom I dip the morsel in. That's the one who will betray me. And he reports that back to Peter, back to the authority. The next time we find this Beloved Disciple is at the cross. And he's there for a very important reason. He is going to be present to the crucifixion. No other disciple is going to be present to the crucifixion, especially Peter. Why? Because Peter is so much in his head and so much in his ego and so afraid. Oh, my goodness gracious, if they discover me, they're going to kill me. I don't want to die. Do you know him? I've never heard of him before in my life. Well, surely you are one of his disciples. No, I am not one of his disciples. And he's cursing, and the cock crows. Not the Beloved Disciple. The Beloved Disciple is at once utterly courageous, because he can be killed, and utterly vulnerable, because he can be killed. I'm discovering lately that vulnerability and courage go hand in hand. I've never met anybody who is courageous who doesn't put themselves out there to make themselves vulnerable. And there he is at the cross. And Jesus looks at the one whom he loves, and he looks at his mother, and he says to his mother, woman. Now, Jesus only uses the term woman twice in all of the Gospel of John referring to his mother. And the first time was at the wedding feast of Cana. Woman, what is this to me and to thee? Well, when he's saying the word woman, he's referring not just to his mother, his physical mother, but to humanity. Because at the wedding feast, she says, well, the zest of life has gone out. The wine has run out. And he's looking at suffering Mary now. And he's saying, I put you in the hands of love. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. The wedding feast between humanity in all of creation in God is knit together in this wonderful, beautiful, heartfelt union of spirit and of love. The next place we see the Beloved Disciple is at the resurrection. Because the beloved disciple is up in the upper room with Peter and the rest, and Mary Magdalene comes and says, they took his body. They've stolen him. And of course, Peter and the disciple get in a foot race to the tomb. They're going to see what happened. They're running and running and running and running and running. Guess who arrives first? Well, if John is 17 years old and Peter's going, trying to, you know who's going to arrive first. Well, that's theological. Theological reason is that love always arrives first. The head, the brain gets us all confused because we are rationalizing, we are splitting. This is good, this is bad. No. Love knows immediately, intuitively. It's the deepest truth we have. So love arrives there first. He looks inside, but then what does he do? It's really amazing. He steps back and he lets Peter go in first. Peter's the authority. He's letting the power, he's letting the law, he's letting the authority go in first. Although Peter goes in and he goes, I don't know what happened. They took his body away. And of course, then we read in the Gospel of John, but the beloved disciple goes in and he believes. He believes. Why? Because he's looking inside and he's seeing the sweatband that Jesus had. It's all rolled up in a neat little place, along with his garment in a neat little place. You're going to steal a body. You're going to rob a body out of it. You're going to be a grave robber. You're not going to do that. He saw it. Why? Because the deepest knowledge is heart knowledge. And that brings us to today, to the gospel today, the third time that Jesus appears to his disciples. And now, Peter has seen Jesus twice already after the death and resurrection. And what does he want to do?
He'll go fishing.
The whole world has changed, but Peter still doesn't get it. This is what I know how to do. This is what we're going to do. Let's go fishing, guys. So he takes them out, and they're out in the boat, and they're fishing away. And of course, being Peter, he catches nothing. All night long, he's been at it. Nothing's going on. Jesus comes and appears for the third time. He says, children, have you caught anything? No, we've been at it all night long. And then throw it over on the starboard side. See if you catch something. And they throw it over, and the nets are just full, and I love this part. The beloved disciples, the first to recognize him, it's the Lord. And then Peter, Mr. Logic, who's almost naked, throws on some clothes and jumps in the river. Is anybody home? And they haul in the net, and I love this part, and they haul in the net and they go, there were 153 fish, large fish. I'm going, who's counting? Who's over there? 1, 2, 3, 153 large fish, and yet the net was not broken. Now the gospel goes on because he's trying to get through to Peter, and so far he hasn't. So he's going to call Peter to the side. He says, come here, Peter. You love me? Now, the Greek word that he is using is agape, or agape, depending on who teaches you your Greek. It's a special kind of love. It's love that is always outward focused. Do you love me? Well, yes, Lord, I love you. Number one. Now, you know he's going to do it three times. Bishop Sheen says he does it three times because he denied him three times. He's got to get it right. Yes, Lord, I love you. Then feed my sheep. Go outside of yourself. I want you to take whatever I'm giving to you right now, which is my heart. I want it to use to spread it around the world. Give it to all. Peter, do you love me? Well, yes, Lord, you know I love you. And tend my flock. Peter, do you love me? Do you agape me? Oh, Peter's getting hurt. His little ego is getting wounded. Oh, you know, he was hurt because it's the third time he's got to ask. Oh, yes, I love you. And then he says, okay, tend my sheep. But it doesn't end there. It takes a long time to learn. You know, we really are Peter. Peter is every man, every woman. Peter is me. I'd love to be say that the beloved disciple is standing, and there's part of me that is, and there's part of each and one of us is the beloved disciple as well, whatever we take in through our heart, but whatever we take in through our head, hello, it's going to take a long time. Because exactly after that, Jesus is telling Peter how he's going to glorify the Lord. He said, you know, when you were a young man, you went anywhere you wanted to go. When you were an old man, someone's going to tie a rope around you and take you where you would rather not go, indicating the kind of death that Peter was to endure on behalf of the Christ. And what does Peter do? I love this. He looks around, he goes, what about him? And he's pointing to the beloved disciple. What about him? He's still not there yet. He's still comparing himself to something else or to someone else. And of course, Jesus says, hey, it's up to me. That's none of your business. Here's your business. Follow me. Follow me. Where? Into the way of the heart. And when John, who lived to be, they think, over 100 years old, was an old, old man, his disciples said, John, all you talk about is love. Love, 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 love. Is that it? Isn't there anything else? And John went back on his heels. He came forward and he said, no, that's it. Get that. You've got it all.